Hey all, welcome to Ron's Tech Reviews. Today we'll be looking at this cooler from Alseye, well, Alseye, so I guess that's how it's pronounced, the M120D-Plus. So in this video, I will be putting it through its paces and finding out if it's good enough to cool a Ryzen 9 5900X overclocked to 4.4 GHz at 1.2 volts. So let's get to it. Full disclaimer, this cooler was provided to me by Store974 in Qatar. The only clause that I have signed up with them is that I have to return this cooler in one piece, how I got it in the box. So if you live in Qatar and you haven't heard about Store974, go check out their store and check out this advert from them.
Need a custom built PC gaming rig? Need to upgrade that old computer? Need some great accessories to step up your game? Are you having problems with your gaming rig or need it repaired? Do all this and much more at Store 974. Store 974, let the games begin.
And if you happen to buy something from them, please don't forget to use the code RONSTECHREVIEWS to get a 3% discount on your purchase.
On to the unboxing. So on the front of the box, we find the image of the cooler showing the OLED display and the model number written on top, the M120D+. At the back, we find the product specifications. I know it's a bit subtle, so I will overlay the specifications over here. Opening the outer box, we find a smaller box inside. This contains the user manual, a thermal paste tube and an applicator, and a Ziploc bag containing the mounting brackets and the screws. Now back to the box, we find the cooler is well protected in a thermocol package. And on this thermocol package, we find a good quality screwdriver, which is convertible from a flat head to a Phillips head. And it's quite long, so it's meant to reach all the way through the cooler and onto the mounting screws. Now removing one half of the thermocol package, we find the air cooler. There is a bunch of cables that is permanently attached to the air cooler. On the top, we find a glossy plastic surface, which I believe is the OLED display. And it's all kind of cheap plastic, but okay. Now the cold plate is the direct touch copper heat pipes. There are six of them, which have been pressed and kind of polished, but it has a lot of scuff marks on it. So it does not have a mirror finish. The fin array of this cooler looks like it's made from aluminium rather than steel. So on one side, the fan is exhausting the air, while the other is intaking the air. The fans are also quite plasticky, but let's see how well it does the job. And the plastics on this is quite cheap, and it's not quite heavy as the Scythe Mugen 5 that I reviewed before. So I believe this is due to the fact that it's mostly aluminium rather than steel or any other heavy metal. Now back to the cables, we find the ARGB 3-pin port, which is also a DC chain port, so you can attach other ARGB fans or strips onto this and you will not lose a header on your motherboard. And then we have the SATA cable and finally the fan PWM port. Now onto the mounting brackets. These are combo mounting brackets, meaning this two mounting brackets will be used for both Intel and AMD. So for the AM4 and for the Intel 1200 series, we'll be using the same mounting mechanism, but we will be using the different holes provided in each of these mounting brackets. So on the top mounting bracket, we see the AM4 is written on this particular hole, which means the four holes over here will be for the AM4 AMD platform, while the side oblong holes are for the Intel ones. Now on the bottom mounting bracket, we find the same labels. So this one over here is for the Intel, while the other is for the AMD. So in one Ziploc bag, we find the mounting screws for the X299 series, while in the other Ziploc bag, we find the mounting screws, standoffs, and spacers. These mounting screws and standoffs will be used for the common Intel and AMD motherboards. These are the thumb screws that will tighten the top mounting bracket onto the motherboard, while these are the four screws or standoff that come in between the motherboard and the top mounting bracket. And the below two parts are the standoff and the spacers. So as said before, these two parts are for the bottom mounting bracket, while the other two are for the top mounting bracket. Now talking about the bottom mounting bracket, you see that there's a notch on the black and there's a notch hole on the standoff. So these two have to be aligned and go in together. So this is how it's going to be. But the mounting plate will come in between these two parts. While for the top mounting bracket, we will have the standoff and the thumb screw over here like this. Now to give you an example, the mounting of the bottom plate and the mounting screws will be like this. We insert the standoff from one side while the black spacer comes from the other side. So for AMD, please ensure to insert the standoff at this part of the hole, not on the other, while the other part is just to hold the screw in place. So repeating this process on all four corners, we have prepped the bottom mounting plate. As explained before, this part will go behind your motherboard. After you have this inserted behind the motherboard through the mounting holes, now we will screw in the front standoffs. Now after tightening the front standoffs, we can place the top plate. Then we will tighten this top plate using the thumb screws. This is how it's going to look like when it's all complete. But there will be a motherboard in between all of this. Now on to the actual mounting of this cooler. As shown here, ensure that you have the standoff and the spacers placed on the correct holes on the back plate. Now after you have it correctly aligned, insert the top standoff and tighten it well. With all the top standoff tightened, we place the top mounting plate. Then with the thumb screws, we tighten the top mounting plate. You don't need to use any screwdrivers for this. Just use your finger strength to ensure that it's well tightened. Now we have the whole mounting mechanism done. Before placing the CPU cooler, I will apply a thermal paste. I will be using Noctua's NT-H1 thermal paste so that I have a consistent thermal paste used in all the CPU cooler reviews that I'm going to do henceforth. So I applied a decent amount and spread it using the applicator to ensure an even thermal paste coverage over the CPU block. Please don't forget to remove the plastic film at the bottom of the cooler. Remove the top cover. Now just place the cooler on top of the CPU and ensure the spring tension mounting screws on the cooler is aligned to the mounting holes in the bracket. As it spring loaded screws, tighten the screws till it doesn't turn anymore. But ensure that you tighten the screws alternatively. Do not all the way tighten one side of the cooler, then move on to the other. Just give it an even twist as you keep on tightening the cooler from one end to the other. With that, we have the CPU cooler all mounted. With this cooler, it's almost impossible to have all four RAM sticks filled. The fan shroud blocks one RAM slot of the motherboard. So you can use only two RAM sticks with this cooler. But I'm not sure this will also be the case in Intel motherboards. Then after placing the motherboard with the cooler back into the case, simply connect the SATA power cable, then connect the 4-pin PWM fan cable to the CPU fan header. And then finally, connect the ARGB cable to any of the 3-pin ARGB ports on the motherboard. Then the only thing remaining is to place back the top cover back onto the CPU cooler shroud. Now on to the performance of this cooler. Before that, I will talk about the common test conditions. The room ambient temperature is set at 22 degrees Celsius. The CPU is overclocked to an all-core 4.4 GHz at 1.2 volts. So in this test condition where the CPU is overclocked, the CPU package power is 150 watts. And I'll be doing two tests on all CPU coolers, one at its max speed and one test with the CPU coolers noise normalized to 40 dBA. The noise reading is taken 50 cm away from the cooler and an open PC case. So on to the graphs. First, I repeated this test conditions with the Scythe Mugen 5. So the Scythe Mugen 5 with its one fan at full speed, which is 1550 RPM, it has a max noise level of 41 dBA. And the max temperature reading was 73.3 degrees Celsius at full load. Now the M120D also at full load and at its full fan speed RPM. One fan spins at 1900 while the other one spins at a maximum of 1800 RPM. It has a max noise level of 47 dB, which is quite audible, but it does a pretty good job in cooling the CPU to a max of 73 degrees Celsius. So in this test condition where the coolers are allowed to give its full performance ability, this cooler manages to keep up with the Scythe Mugen 5 but at a much higher noise level. Now on to the 40 dBA noise normalized test. In this case, the Scythe Mugen 5 fans didn't have to drop much in RPM. The speed of the fan is 1500 RPM and the Scythe Mugen 5 manages to keep the CPU cool at 74 degrees centigrade. Onto the Alseye cooler. Dropping down the RPM down to 1550 RPM on one fan and 1400 on the other, the cooler manages to still cool the CPU, but the max CPU temperature was 76.1 degrees, which is a 3.1 degree difference between the Scythe Mugen 5. So from this we can understand, even though the cooler is not as efficient as the Scythe Mugen 5, it does a pretty good job and it is also quiet as long as you bring down the top speed of the fans. Now visually, this cooler is quite captivating. The RGB lighting is quite nice, it's well diffused, and on top of that we have this OLED display displaying the CPU temperature. But this is where everything is wrong. This temperature reading is completely bogus. It's nowhere close to the exact temperature reading on the CPU die. The actual CPU temperature is shown on the motherboard OLED display over here, or anybody can see the actual temperature reading of the CPU through any monitoring software on their PC. The reason why I believe the temperature reading is completely wrong is because it does not read from the motherboard or from the actual temperature probes on the CPU. From my visual inspection, I saw the cooler has a temperature probe touching the cold plate on the cooler. Due to that fact, this reading is showing the temperature on the cold plate rather than the temperature of the actual CPU die.
So I hope you sat through the whole video and saw how well this cooler is performing, even for a budget cooler like this. So what are my final thoughts about this cooler? Well, if you require a truly fully RGB cooler, then this is hands down the one you need to go for. And it performs well even to cool a moderately overclocked Ryzen 9 5900X. The only cons that I can say about this cooler is that the build quality is quite low. It uses a lot of cheap plastics. The temperature reading is totally out of whack. It's nowhere close to the actual CPU temperature reading. And the mounting mechanism is a bit complicated and a bit hectic. Especially in my case where I have already built the system, I had to take the whole motherboard out to fit it all back together again. So these are some cons that you need to take note of. So even considering all that cons, the cooler does what it needs to do. It cools the CPU and in addition, it gives a lot of RGB. So if you're interested in buying this cooler and you live in Qatar, check out store 974. And if you're not from Qatar, I'll drop in the links down below where you can get them internationally. That's about it for this video. If you have any questions, please drop in a comment and I will get back to you. Please click on the like button if you like this video. If you haven't subscribed yet, click on the subscribe and the bell icon to be notified of my future videos. And stay safe and take care.
If you haven't watched my full review on the Scythe Mugen 5, click on the video that is popping up right now. Or watch any of my other videos.